What's up, geeks, and welcome to the channel. In one of our previous uploads, we discussed recursion and how to come up with recursive methods given a particular problem. So if you haven't watched that video, I suggest you check it out before proceeding with this one. Today we are going to explain tail recursion. What distinguishes tail recursive methods from normal ones, and most importantly, how to transform a recursive into a tail recursive method, and why do you want to do that if you want to do it? Now, simply put, a recursive method is referred to as tail recursive when the recursive call is the last thing executed by that method. Otherwise, it's known as head recursive. Take the print numbers method you see in front of you as an example. This method will keep printing the integers starting from a given number until the number reaches 1. So if the input of this method is a 10, the output will be the numbers from 10 all the way to 1. Notice how the last statement executed by this method is a recursive call, making it a tail recursive method. Okay, what about the factorial method we implemented in the last recursion video? Is it tail recursive? Well, if we were to rewrite in a not so concise way as we've done here, you will realize that the returned and last statement executed by the method is the multiplication and not the recursion, meaning that the method we previously implemented is not actually tail recursive, so it is head recursive. Now, before we transform it into a tail recursive one, let's see why do we even want to do that? What are the benefits of having a tail recursive method? You see, tail recursive methods are optimized by certain compilers. These compilers usually execute recursive calls with the help of a stack. This stack stores all the relevant information of each recursive call. In case of a tail recursive method, and since a recursive call is the last statement executed, there is no need to reserve a place in that stack for that particular call or any call following it, because there is nothing left to do in the current method and we won't be returning to the parent call. This is referred to as tail call optimization or elimination. Now, although the Java compiler can make use of this optimized memory, you should note that at the moment, the JVM doesn't optimize tail recursive calls. Okay, to explain tail recursion further and make things clearer, let's try to transform our previously implemented head recursive method into a tail recursive one. Then we'll go ahead and visualize the stack memory of each of those methods when they are executed. What you see is the implementation of the factorial method as a tail recursive method. Let's break it down. Notice that you have two methods instead of one. The original method was turned into a helper method and is now being called with an initial value. This initial value, in most cases, will be the return value of the stop condition we had in the original recursive call. Take note here that the hints I am giving you may not apply while transforming any method to a tail call, but yes, they do apply on most. The next thing you may have noticed is how we included the multiplication, which was the operation executed after the recursive call, inside the recursion itself as an accumulator, and it is the final result of that accumulator that is being returned to the user when the calculation is finished. You see, in a tail recursive method, the result of the stop condition is actually the result of the whole recursion, because that is what will be returned by all the child calls all the way to the parent and initial call. I know this is tough, so before proceeding to the visualization part, let's transform the second example we covered in the previous video as well, the Fibonacci sequence. What you see is the implementation of the Fibonacci sequence as a tail recursive method. Let's go over it in detail. Similarly to the factorial one, the original method was broken into two, a caller and a helper method. The caller method is using as initial values the return values of the stop conditions we previously had. The result, or the addition, is now accumulated inside the recursive call. And because the recursion is called on the previous value of our current call as well in the initial method, we need to keep track of the previous value of the recursive call using an additional parameter. And that's it. Now, before visualizing the call stack of each method, keep in mind that 1. The continuation passing style, or CPS, might be the only generic way out that allows you to transform any code into a form that uses only tail calls. And the results you will obtain are ugly, sometimes slow, and not the subject of today's video. Maybe we'll discuss this in the future. 2. Not all logics can be made tail recursive. You see, most recursions are linear, but some are not. And nonlinear recursions, such as a few tree recursions, must maintain a variable or a state somewhere, and that somewhere is the stack memory. With that said, let's go ahead and visualize the stack memory of each recursive method we implemented, and I guarantee after this you will have a better understanding of how tail recursion works and on why tail call optimization is such a big deal sometimes. So, when factorial 5 is invoked, let's say, these calls will be respectively added to the stack, and we won't be able to start popping from this stack before we reach the stop condition of the recursion. When that happens, the values we have will start to get replaced and the stack calls will be popped. However, if we try this on the tail recursive method, the first call is that of the factorial method, and the second is that of the recursive call. When factorial 4 is called, because no variables are required to be stored in the frame left by the parent call of the same recursive method, and because both of these calls will have the same return value, then the same frame will be used to store the new call details. Now, if we go ahead and compare the stacks corresponding to the recursive methods at their maximum depth, you will see that the space complexity of recursion was reduced from O of n to O of 1, thanks to tail call elimination. So, as a recap, in tail recursion, when a child method is called, it finishes immediately. It doesn't have to return back to its parent. And as no computation is performed on the returned value and no statements are left for execution, there is no need to preserve the stack frames of the previous method calls, thus allowing us to execute the recursion in constant memory space, making tail recursion faster and friendlier than head recursion in terms of memory. So, that's it for this video. I hope it was helpful. Thank you guys for watching. Take care, and I will see you in the next one.